We're getting ready to go here on the Hill to bring the legislation to the floor of the House and get this deal done and updated for the 21st century. And we had a great conversation with the president. And I will tell you, we're working hand in hand with the administration to bring relief to American workers, American manufacturing, as well as our farmers across the country.
You know, when the president had talked about pulling NAFTA and not having a replacement in place, it seemed to me that Congress was speaking with a pretty united front, and both parties were saying that they wanted to see a new deal, that it was important to have that deal there, that something needed to be there. But now the more we hear, the more contentious the whole plan sounds. What do you think you're facing in terms of trying to get enough people on board to approve this?
Well, you know, obviously, the gridlock up here on the Hill is alive and well, and what we need to do is put American people first and the American worker first. And so Nancy Pelosi is going to have a choice. She's going to have a choice. Is she going to stand with our American farmers? Is she going to stand with the American workers, get this deal in place? Or are we going to have a situation where, you know, you go back and repeal and terminate the NAFTA agreement, and you're going to be looking at a choice there that would be catastrophic not only to our interests here in America, but Canada and Mexico's economy could not sustain the termination of NAFTA.
Congressman Reed, let's strip it down, though. Rather than really getting into deep political divisions on this, what really needs to happen? Where are you kind of counting things when you start looking at the whip numbers, when you start looking at what has to happen? Where are the deals that need to be cut, and what are the big issues?
Yeah, I think the biggest issues really are on enforcement, and then also targeting those members in agricultural districts as well as manufacturing districts, where they have the stakeholders that are going to speak loud and clear and say, look, we need this agreement on the books because we've updated it, we've made it better for the 21st century, and thank the president for leading on this issue. This has been talked about for years. Now is the time for action. And those members who say no, just because they're concerned about a political vocal minority, are going to be held accountable at the election polls.
Yeah, I was going to say, you represent Corning, New York. Obviously, it's a big issue in New York because of the dairy farmers, a huge industry. What is New York dairy farmers, the second biggest dairy farmer coalition in the country?
Absolutely.
So yeah. Where I would anticipate there would be a lot of agricultural districts where people would get on board with this. I would anticipate around Detroit. And any place else where they have auto manufacturing, it would be an issue where they want to see things passed. Where do you think you're going to get the biggest pushback?
I think we're going to get the pushback from maybe the urban settings and also those that are just beholden to that extreme left agenda that's overtaken Washington right now, where they're not going to want to give President Trump a victory just for political purposes. And that is so wrong. And we're going to highlight them. We're going to put the sun on them. And they're going to have to be held accountable to the American worker and the American farmer.
Do you think the president, judging by what you discussed with him yesterday, really would go back to abolishing NAFTA altogether if his deal doesn't pass?
It is a tool in the toolbox. Now, we don't want to go down that path, but necessary, but it will be necessary potentially. And that is a tool that is going to be on the table and would be deployed. So people in Canada and Mexico also have to understand that, too. That we are ready to move, and that if we don't get an agreement here, we're not going to go back to the status quo.
Kayla had mentioned that the one big sticking issue that still remains people aren't sure about is the steel and aluminum tariffs. Where does that stand? Will they be taken off of Canada and Mexico?
Well, you know, obviously, as we get the agreement on the books, that is something we're going to advocate for, because then you have equal, fair, level trade agenda between all the countries involved. But at the end of the day, you know, those tariffs have to be there in order to move the leverage forward, move the opportunities forward to get this to the floor and update the agreement.
It's your understanding, though, that the president would also be in favor of taking those tariffs off if the new NAFTA goes through?
And potentially. It's all about enforcement, too. It's all about how are we going to make sure that the quotas and the other provisions that are potentially being negotiated to ensure that enforcement of the agreement is in place after we approve it.
What sort of enforcement issues are you talking about? I know that that's been a huge issue in the trade talks with China. I can't recall a lot of issues in the past where there's been as much contention surrounding enforcement when it comes to Canada and Mexico.
Well, it's about the issue of having the enforcement up front, as opposed to, you know, having a situation where you have to litigate it after the damages have been imposed. And also these paper tiger type of provisions that are just in paper, but there's no relief to the offending or the individual that is hurt in the transaction. Bottom line is enforcement's like immediate access, immediate enforcement of tariffs if there's not an action that will relieve the aggressive action.
I would just ask what you think the odds are in terms of being able to get this shepherded through Congress at this point.
And I think they're growing each and every day.
Growing from 20%, growing from 50%, yeah. Growing from 70%.
You know, obviously, I can't guarantee anything up here on the Hill, but I will give you the estimate that I think is accurate, that not 0% of passage is not realistic. Something has to give. Something has to go forward. So I'm very confident we'll be able to get there.
In terms of other trade, do you have a question?
No, I was going to say, do you feel the president's focus is on this at the moment, or how distracted is he from China with this particular issue?
No, I think he's definitely focused on this because the negotiation between Mexico and Canada has set the platform upon provisions being negotiated with China and future countries such as Japan. Things like currency manipulation that are in this provision. You know, I advocated for that. I was a strong proponent of making sure that currency manipulation is in this agreement so that as we go forward, we're negotiating from that gold standard of language that we were able to achieve here.
And do you think we still need something like a TPP or some sort of...
No, I think we can do this, take each country at one step at a time. Mexico, Canada here, obviously we had the NAFTA framework to work within, but now we move with the China negotiations, you got Japan, you got the EU. Those are the next steps on the road to a new trade agreement, true trade agenda for America.